Kalosh.
So this is the title, and I'll just apologize because I'm not an astronomer, and still I'll try to tell the best I can. So I'll start with Gerhard's famous picture about high energy physics and where we are. He called it desert, and the story goes that there was a great expectation that we will learn from LHC more than Higgs, but so far we didn't. And of course there is a grand unification scale over there, and gravity. And what was not in Gerhard's picture was B-modes. And so if we will succeed, our generation, or in, I don't know, next 20 years, if we succeed to find the information here, we are jumping 10 order of magnitudes from LHC. And this is why it is so difficult in the first place. So as the measure of tensor to scalar modes is now viewed as less than 0.07, which means it could be much below, but in terms of Hawking temperature of gravitational radiation, we're talking about 10 to the 13 GV, and so we have this at least 10 order of magnitude jump, and this is why it is so dramatically difficult. Some other people prefer to use the measure of this energy instead of h squared and Planck squared, they call it e to the 4, and then they talk that this is the energy of grand unification. So, this is the current picture of a huge effort people are making to, those are ground-based experiments, and on top of it, so they are either in Atacama or on South Pole, but there is also discussion of opportunities in Tibet and in Greenland, and this is quite serious. Those are satellite projects, and probably we will hear much more from Francois later. But these are all targeting B-modes, and people now are talking not as much about what R is, but what is sigma of R. So what is the precision of this measurement? And so very soon there will be another paper of Bicep and Keck, and their main goal is to tell us about sigma rather than bound on R. So just to connect to what everybody knows, there was this great discovery of gravity waves, and now we believe that general relativity works extremely well even at strong gravity. However, the primordial B modes, which we are trying to detect, are so many orders of magnitude different, and this is the problem, of course. And so just to give you the difference, so the wavelengths of detected gravity waves are thousands of kilometers, whereas the primordial are billions of light years. So this is from the recent discussion of what are the difficulties in detection of B-modes. A removal of foregrounds, control of systematics, and achieving required sensitivity. And so everybody wants to see are of the order 10 to the minus 3 eventually, and this is hard, and there was all this dust which clouded the story, but there is a belief that if, however, we will still be able to detect waves or to put more significant bounds, it will be very important with understanding of quantum gravity. So this is a picture again that it is a consensus that there was inflation early here, and that gravitational waves are coming from the early times and much earlier than CMB polarization. And analogous picture here I'd like to show that those primordial gravity waves, they were created approximately 13.8 billion years ago, somewhere here, and if we detect them, would be great. And the gravitational waves detected by LIGO from black hole merger, they came from about 1.3 billion years ago, somewhere from here. And we are happy that they have been discovered. And of course, it was 100 years ago they were predicted. And those B-modes were predicted relatively not so old, long time ago. So let's go and talk about string theory landscape, which is one possibility to address this incredibly small number. What is 10 to the minus 120 and how to deal with this? And the latest number, which was shown at the recent CMBS4, is quite striking. So it is 0.99 plus minus 0.6. There is certain combination of data you can put together, which was shown just in February at CMBS4, and there was an explanation that clusters could have spoiled cosmological concordance model, but in fact they didn't. And so the equation of state is rather closer to minus one than it was some number of years ago, and clusters just helped. So this number, 10 to the minus 120, is not something anybody ever had to deal with. And there was, there exists an anthropic approach to lambda in string theory. And the concept of string theory landscape suggests the following. This KKLT construction by myself and Kachro and Linda and Trivedi suggests how to construct the sitter vacuum in string theory. And I'll just mention this word. They are called uplifting anti-D3 brains. And this is a certain non-perturbative feature of string theory which allows the sitter vacuum. And so the idea is the following, that we have a huge number of those vacua, and they are all kind of things before quantum corrections. And after quantum corrections, they just mixed up, and still you have some of them in this entropic bound before and some of them later. So it is not possible to say first you achieve 10 to the minus 120 and then quantum correction will keep you there. It's something else. This is radically new approach, and I think nobody was able to say anything better with regard to the explanation. But the fact that W is very close to minus one has to be taken seriously. You can't change it. And so this is the only way to address the issue which is known. We would be happy to have something better, though. So, as I told you, I'll just quickly mention that the same technical tool which we used to construct string theory landscape turned out to be extremely useful for inflationary model building and for predictions for target of B modes, which I'll try to explain. And this is just to tell you that there exists a construction which has to do with something which is called nilpotent Goldsteiner, and again has to do with anti-D3 brains. And for non-expert, is just the following, that very early in the 70s, Volkov and Akulov invented something called nonlinear supersymmetry. So the one supersymmetry which was not found at LHC is known as linear supersymmetry. Every particle has a superpartner, and they were looking for it. And it was extremely difficult. There were no Go theorem. You can't construct the sitter vacuum. Whereas, if you go back to the early years, so Volkov-Akulov constructed a model where there was only fermion, and they called them Goldsteiner. There were no partners. So if you use this particular construction, you go around no-go theorem, and supersymmetry is spontaneously broken. And in this construction, in string theory, you just realize something which is called nilpotent Goldsteiner, and I'll use it a little bit to tell you that this is an extremely useful tool for model buildings. So let me tell you that what was interesting, now that LHC has not told us anything but Higgs, what seemed to be happening, so this, it was interesting situation recently at Stanford, and because it was at SLAC, I was part of CMBS4, and I noticed there were people from DOE, high energy physics, from NSF, astronomy, of course, but also from physics, and not only from polar programs. And so they kind of want to develop a concept of CMBS4, and their science requirement is inflation, which includes R or sigma of R, and of course neutrinos, and maybe light relics. And it was clear that all money which was tunneled in particle experimental physics, at least agencies are looking at how to connect to other things. So what was understood that, of course, the B modes consist of Q and U maps, and the goal is 10 to the minus 3, and it is extremely difficult, and that is what it is. And I also wanted to show you the picture which was shown by Karlstrom, who is the leader of CMBS4. And so the picture shows you the combination of Planck, ACT, and SPT. And what you see here, that inflation checklist, according to Karlstrom, is that flat geometry is rather well established. The number of harmonic peaks is 9. There are Gaussian random fields. Non-Gaussianity is small. And there is a departure from scale invariance, and S is 9.6. And of course, the issue of gravitational waves is something we are looking forward to see. So let me introduce some dictionary. So the N is the number of E folds left to the end of inflation, defined through the scale factor of the universe at the end of the inflation and now. So the spectrum of fluctuation, usually people now assume it is between 47 and 57. Now, NS is the tilt of spectrum of inflationary perturbation, and this is the reasonable value. R is level of B modes, ratio of tensor to scalar fluctuation. They have not been detected. The number is below 0.7. Now, I will introduce another N, which is number of supersymmetries, number of Majorana spinners. And the maximal number for theories with high spin 2 is known to be n equals 8. And the minimal number which we'll consider is n equals 1. And so the new targets for B modes will be described, and they have to do with models where you start with maximal number of supersymmetries, which could be either M theory or string theory or maximal supergravity. And you reduce this model to N equals 1, and then you ask, what are good models and how they predict the B mode targets? So this is the picture which was shown in many talks at CMBS4. And as you see here, people do want to discover B-modes, and Susan Stacks called the future as relentless observations. This is what is expected. Now, I would like to explain this picture. So this is, those are excluded already, and those are valid. And so if B-modes will be discovered soon, which would mean that R is above 10 to the minus 2, that will include, for example, nature and inflation. You see, nature inflation goes down, but then it goes too much to the left. Or axion monodromy are here, so they're fine. All these models are fine. So if B-modes will be discovered during the next 5 years, maybe 10, those all models will work well. Some of them alpha attractors, I'll explain more. And all of them will be validated. And there will be no need to worry about going to the logarithmic scale in R. However, If they will not be discovered, we want to zoom at this area of smaller r, and this is what will happen. So with regard to alpha attractors, the models which I'll describe, the story is interesting that they have, in the beginning, you could start with phi to the 6 or phi squared or phi, but then when you go to relatively small r, they all combine into one line. And those are models of the kind Tanch of the inflaton to the power 2n, and there is this very important factor 6 alpha, or 1 minus exponent to this power. And what this picture exists for some number of years, and when I noticed that alpha equals 1/3 correspond to r 10 to the minus 3, which is a target for satellite experiments. So I noticed that this is maximal superconformal theory. And then, to my surprise, Lyman Page asked me, can you please check your computation? Because, for example, Higgs inflation and Starobinsky inflation have factor 3 higher. So, and then he explained to me that my calculation better be correct, because it will cost some number of hundreds of millions of dollars, which was rather unexpected for a factor of 1/3. So it is confirmed now. Indeed, there is this factor, which is in a current target for satellite experiment. So this is from a relatively recent slide of Kamatsu, who says the following things. He says that why all of this is so important to nail down specific model of inflation, because we are closing in on the first 10 to the minus 35 seconds of the universe, and we use general relativity and quantum field theory. We would like to know what controls these models. And so his point is that already, because the new bounds on R, number of models have been ruled out. A number of models are still there. So the one which I called alpha attractors are those two yellow stripes here. And to explain the significance of this parameter alpha, let me remind you what, of course, everybody knows, that for many decades, the meaning of the measurements of the curvature of three-dimensional space was very important, because it was just a measure of what kind of geometry we live in. And so the current number is really small, which tells us it is very close to flat universe, the three-dimensional. So the curvature is the curvature of the space-time metric. Meanwhile, in the context of models which I am describing here, the measurements of R will be a measurement of curvature of the hyperbolic geometry of the modular space. So the scalars in string theory and supergravity, they're not scalars, they're coordinates of some geometry. And to identify this geometry and measure its curvature is exactly what will happen. So one of the points here is that once you decide to use this hyperbolic geometry, which is extremely often in string theory and supergravity, you find that the tilt of the spectrum is given by the formula 1 minus 2 divided by n, where n is a number of e-foldings of inflation, and this is a very good description of the experiment. Whereas r is given by a very simple formula, alpha 12 divided by n squared. So in a sense, those models are very simple. Now, the parameter alpha is given, it defines the curvature of so-called Keller geometry. And again, my friend experimentalist asked me to explain it better. So a better explanation, because the decreasing r means decreasing alpha and increasing curvature. And so the explanation, which was more satisfactory for some of them, and you will see why, is that hyperbolic geometry is also known as a Poincaré disk, which was presented by Escher very often. And so 3 alpha is the r squared of the Escher disk. And if the r will be measured, if the gravity B modes will be detected, in the context of these models, because NS is already sitting in place, it will be a measurement of this square of the Escher disk. And so let me show you what the CMB S4 book has. So this is the story, that now they also use logarithmic scale here for the future. And so this is more or less CMB S4 expectation. They will be maybe a little bit below 10 to the minus 2. And now those are phi squared and phi and phi 2/3, they're all here. Higgs and R squared are a couple of points here. And this gray stripe is our alpha attractors model, because they just want to go down and they are already sitting in a reasonable position. And I explained to you what is the meaning of this alpha. It's a curvature of Escher disk. So then, because these models have 1 minus 2 over n, the position of this stripe is somewhat flexible. We can move in both directions by changing the number of e-folding, for which we have to find a good end of the model, what kind of reheating will support them. And so they're very flexible in this respect. So here again is the CMBS4 science book with various stages. And so when we looked at this, it was looking like not much. And so with Sergio Ferrara, and then more recently with Linda Raz and Yamada, we constructed models which populate this area. And this is what I'll explain now. So the ground-based experiments will go up till here, but for the future B-mode satellite missions, we have now new targets, which I'm going to explain. So partially for entertainment and partially because instead of a disk, you can use half plane. And in fact, both were known to Escher. He constructed these woodcuts in the form of a disk, and what you see here, it's a curved space, and therefore the size of angels and demons near the boundary is just because you are plotting a curved space on a flat surface. But in fact, it's just a wrong view. If you would make a better picture, not on the flat, the angels and demons here are exactly of the same size as this one. And there is an alternative description which is known in mathematical literature when you go from a disk. The important thing, you have a boundary, and then you go to the half plane. So, and just one, apologize for the formula, just to explain that if you are in supergravity or in string theory, there is something known as duality symmetry, as L2R symmetry, and the geometry is for the disk like that, and for the half plane like that, and there is a curvature. So if you have a disk, your complex variable ZZ bar is less than 1. And accordingly, if you have a half plane, you can also calculate the curvature because you have a line element, and you get the same expression. So those are models which have plateau potentials, which are known to be useful in explaining the data. And so either you work with canonical inflaton, and then you have a Tansch potential, or you work with the geometric disk potential, and then, kinetic term, and then your potential just ZZ bar. There is nothing simpler than that. And the same in here. So you have geometric variables and canonical variables. And this is why hyperbolic geometry always gives you those flat plateau in canonical variables. Those models were known for a while, And so they have this feature that they go into the sweet spot of the data. And then the question is, what is alpha? And this is something which we have to measure. So I am approaching the discussion of the most recent targets. And so I can start with any of these models, either M theory and D equals 11, which is why I called from the sky to fundamental physics. So what we know about the fundamental physics, the best we know today. There's M theory and D equals 11, superstring theory and D equals 10, or maximal N equals 8 supergravity and D equals 4. And if you start there, the scalars are coordinates of something called coset space. And the coset space is defined by E77, which is one of the groups, over SU8. And the beautiful feature of E77 that it consists of exactly 7 Poincaré disks. So if by some reason you can identify those disks, then you can perform a consistent truncation from maximal supersymmetry to minimal. Once this is done, you'll get this number K, which could take value 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. What is interesting, at least one disk and no more than 7. And there is nothing you can do here. It's just the way it is. So if you take 55 e-foldings, then you have already a nice, comfortable, consistent with the data value of the tilt of the spectrum. And suddenly you see that R is between, roughly speaking, 10 to the minus 2 and 10 to the minus 3. Those were empty spots. There were just two models, Higgs and Starobinsky, in one place. Now we have a family of very interesting models. So this is, sorry, it's a slide full of equations. Don't look at the equations. The most surprising thing happened, it was a recent paper. We sent it to GHEP in the evening, and next morning it was accepted. Never happened before. Because the result is very simple. what we used to make a choice of Keller frame is something which is known, maybe some people know here, about tessellation. So when you deal with the hyperbolic geometry, there is something associated with tessellation which has different parts, how the structure repeat, and it is the inversion inside the disk which keeps those angels and demons small near the boundary, which helped us to find the stable inflationary trajectory, because we have so many moduli. It was necessary to find only one light and everybody else heavy. So what we did here was, more recently, to actually construct, in terms of Keller and superpotential, the models, and then using this tessellation. And then we run Mathematica, the model works beautifully, and so the punchline is here. NS is approximately 1 minus 2 over N, so the tilt of the spectrum is in place. R is given by 3 alpha times 4 over N squared, and this one is taking value 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 1, and each of them has very specific property. So why do we find it useful to talk about the size of the Escher disk in discussion of the CMB future B-mod targets? That's why. So what you see, the blue means those are already ruled out by the earlier data. In terms of our alpha attractor models, those are the future possibilities. So if they will be discovered very soon, one of these will work, or it will be natural inflation, or it will be axion monodromy. There are many models which are still valid. But then we need a beam out soon. If by 10 to the minus 2, which is presumably where the ground-based experiment will probably not be strong enough, and we need the satellite, now this area is quite populated. And I'll just show you what is the relation between the targets and the disks. And so when I presented this work recently at CMBS4, there was very interesting reaction of two cosmologists. So, few of them. So, Karlstrom and Zaldriaga told me they like one disk because it allows them to give a good targets for satellite missions. Whereas Chaolin told me he likes 7 because he has a good chance to discover them on ground. Anyway, I think the analogy is just there is a very formal theoretical physics associated with maximal number of supersymmetry. And we're talking about 10 to the minus 35 seconds. And why not consider those models? They are relatively simple. That is their advantage. And they're falsifiable by the data. So to summarize, based on CMB data and the value of the tilt of the spectrum, NS as a function of number of e-folds, we have deduced that hyperbolic geometry of a Poincaré disk suggests a way to explain the experimental formula. This formula was discussed in various groups, and the only case which I know where you actually associate it with anything in the theoretical physics is to say that if you agree on hyperbolic geometry, this is your formula. And this is what Zaldariaga and Criminelli recently were discussing. And the main point is this type of formula fits the data. And I'm adding to this. We studied this kind of model. At that time, we didn't know that the data will be around this. But then it is a very simple connection. Well, thank you. I even have less. So the next point here, that using a consistent reduction from maximal n equals 8 supersymmetry, M theory in D equals 11, string theory in D equals 10, maximal supergravity in D equals 4, to the minimal n equals 1 supersymmetry, we have deduced the favorite models with hyperbolic geometry. And they have this R squared of Escher, accordingly 7 up to 1. I mean, it's good to have a falsifiable by the data model, which follows simultaneously from M theory, string theory, and maximal supergravity, I would say. And the point is, we just had a recently, not recently, a few years ago, Stefano Bellucci organized a workshop at Frascati precisely about those duality symmetries. One of them is E77. But it turns out it has just 7 disks, and here we go. So now we have a target for the future BMOD experiments. And I'm sure that the theoretical part will be also developed. And it has to do also, there's some connection with the result which were presented here by Meissner and Nicolai, that in n equals 8, four-dimensional supergravity, all conformal anomalies vanish. Those are the same theories which lead to these predictions. And therefore, it is rather interesting. So the BMOD targets are now 0.9 10 to the minus 2 up to approximately 1 10 to the minus 3. And this is in strong contrast of case of n equals 1, because for n equals 1, r squared is arbitrary. And so I showed for a few years those attractors, and there was no preferred places to look at. Now those discrete, exactly 1 to 7, are representing 7 disks of the maximal duality symmetry known in all of these models. So again, this is the picture about ground-based experiments that we have populated this area. And even more striking, if we look at the core, and maybe we'll hear more from Francois in his talk, that between 10 to the minus 3 and 10 to the minus 2, there will be hopefully some measurements such that there will be something from core and something from light birth together. There will be improved factor for NS, which is very significant, because for our models, it will define the number of effoldings. The number of effolding is not defined by cosmological model. We have to attach to the end of inflation, the reheating, and how it connects to the rest of the world. And if we know NS better, we will know how in this model to identify N, and then we'll also have to see what R will be, or the bound on R. And so all of this, of course, will not happen too soon, but it is good to have a theoretical perspective. So this is the slide, again, from John Karstrom, the way he sees. He's the leader of CMBS4 in US. It was really interesting to see how all these DOE and NSF people are trying to use upcoming cosmology to replace, at least for now, the amount of funding which went into high energy experimental particle physics. So he was giving this talk, and this is how he suggests what will happen. As you see, the story will go from here for quite a while, but there is a hope that something will be discovered, or the bound will go down. For example, in string cosmology, there are many models where R starts with 10 to the minus 6. There are so many of them. So why we now give a lot of attention? Because those are falsifiable by the data. And the ones which have R 10 to the minus 6, they're probably not reachable, at least in a lifetime. So that is just to say that his question mark is with regard to 2030. And if you go back to Tuft picture, that we are jumping 10 order of magnitudes from LHC, it would be very important to find something there. And so I'll just finish by this picture, which shows that nobody knows whether they will fly or not. But the proposal seems to go out, and there is an interesting situation that some people want to include neutrino, because if they don't detect B-modes, they don't want to just give us a bound. But if there will be information on neutrino, which could come simultaneously from this satellite mission, at least we will know the best value of the total mass of neutrino and maybe some other things. And because nobody knows whether even 100 TV accelerator in China will be built or when. So I think those projects eventually, somehow, somewhere, will take place. I hope so. Thank you.